good morning, everybody. The first talk on digital equity testing is on three topics: Snellen's chart, Logma chart, and Color Vision. So we start with Snellen's chart. As we all know, Snellen's chart is probably the most common and most widely used visual equity chart we use in ophthalmology. It was first developed by Herman Snellen, a Dutch ophthalmologist. It's used for testing the distant visual acuity. As you can see here, it's a series of black capital letters which are arranged in lines, progressively diminishing in size, and each letter fits into a square. So with a detailed separation of 1/5 letter size between the letters. So what is the basis of Snellen's testing? It is based on the understanding that two distant points can be visible as separate only when they subtend an angle of 1 minute at the nodal point of the eye. So if you look at this picture, you can see that the entire letter subtends an angle of 5 minutes, and each limb and each breadth of the line will subtend an angle of 1 minute at the nodal point if you test it at the distance of 6 meters. So let's come to the procedure of testing. So we are all aware of the how it is tested. For the sake of the first year postgraduates, I'll elaborate on that. The patient is seated comfortably at a distance of 6 meters from the chart. You should have a properly illuminated chart, and patient is asked to read the chart with each eye tested separately. Okay, so how do we interpret the chart? So what is normal visual acuity? So this chart has got the topmost line is supposedly to be read at 60 meters. The next line at 36 meters, the next 24, 18, 12, 9, 6, 5, 4 meters, so on by a normal person. So since we are testing at a fixed distance of 6 meters, the normal person should be comfortably able to read the 6 by 6 line. So that's the normal visual acuity. Now, how do you record the visual acuity of a person? So it is recorded as a numerical fraction. So for example, the numerator is the distance of the patient from the chart. It is usually fixed at 6 meters, and the denominator is the smallest line of letters which is accurately read by the patient. For example, patient is able to, let's say, is able to read this line, that is up to this OLAF line, which is denoted as 6 by 18. So it is a line by line scoring system, and count a line as seen if more than 50% of the optotypes are correctly identified by the patient. What if the patient misses a few letters of a line? For example, let's say the patient reads up to the CTPALO line, but the O is read as D. You denote it as 6 by 9 minus 1. Suppose he reads it as CTRAID, but all of the 6 by 12 line is correctly identified, you can denote it as 6 by 12 plus 3. So what if the patient is not able to read the topmost line of the Snellen's chart at 6 meters? Then you ask the patient to walk towards the chart till he can read the top line. Suppose he reads it at 5 meters, you record it as 5 by 60. If at 4 meters, 4 by 60, then 3 by 60, 2 by 60, 1 by 60, accordingly the distance at which he reads the top line. If he's still not able to see, the patient is asked to count the fingers of the examiners at 3 meters, 2 meters, 1 meters, or close to face. And vision is recorded accordingly as CF 3 meters, 2 meters, CF 1 meters, or counting fingers close to face. Suppose the patient is not even able to count the fingers, the examiner moves his hand close to the patient's face, and if patient appreciates it, it is recorded as hand movements close to face. If patient is not able to see the hand movements, then you have to check for perception of light, which is recorded as PL positive, and if it is negative, or PL negative. If the perception of light is positive, then you have to again check for projection of rays in all the four quadrants and mark them accordingly. Okay, so that was that about the Snellen's chart. Now we come to another chart which is commonly used. It is gaining popularity nowadays, especially in research and studies, because of its more accurate estimate of the visual acuity. And that chart is the Logma chart, or the logarithm of minimum angle of resolution. It is also called the Bailey-Love chart, and it is also used in the, also known as the ETDRS chart, because it was used in the ETDRS study. So standard testing distance is 4 meters, but nowadays we have digital Logma charts which can be adjusted to use at 2 meters, 3 meters, etc. So the acuity, the visual acuity, becomes less as the logMAR value increases. As you can see here, so logMAR of 0.3 has a better visual acuity than a logMAR of 0.6. And the brightness decreases line by line, and it's a better estimate of visual acuity than the Snellen's chart. I'll tell you why later. So how do you come to this logMAR chart? How do you assess this logMAR chart? So here, the visual acuity is scored with reference to the minimum angle of resolution. So that means resolution of 1 minute of visual angle is taken as logMAR 0 because log of 1 is 0. So I'll come to that later and explain to you in detail. So now you look at this logMAR chart. Suppose you interpret this visual acuity testing by the logMAR chart. So each letter of the logMAR is about 0.02 log units. And each line is 5 letters. So the difference, the score for each line is 0.1 log units. So between the two lines, there's a change of 0.1 log units. And the geometric progression of size and spacing is 0.1 log unit of 4/5. So how do you calculate the score of a patient? For example, let's say the patient reads the entire 0.4 line, but reads only 2 letters of the 0.3 line. So how do you calculate it? So this is the formula, logMAR visual acuity is equal to logMAR value of the best line, which is partly read, that is 0.3 plus 0.02 into the number of optotypes missed in that line. So 3 optotypes were missed. So 0.02 into 3 will be 0.06. So it will be 0.3 plus 0.06 will be 0.36 will be the visual acuity of that patient for that patient in logMAR. So what is the advantage of logMAR over the other charts? So you can see there is a logMAR chart and a Snellen's chart, which is kept side by side. The advantage of logMAR is if you can see that each line has the same number of letters, 5 letters in the logMAR. As it comes down progressively, also 5 letters are there. Whereas in Snellen's, the number of letters differs in each line. And also the font is Sloan font, which is easier to understand, sans serif. Sans serif means there is no stroke of the letter. So some letters are easier to identify than the other letters in the Snellen's chart. We all know children can sometimes memorize the entire chart and read it by heart, whereas the logMAR is more difficult to memorize and difficult to bluff. And the letter size varies from line to line logarithmically, as is the space also. So between the two letter space is the width of a single letter, and between two line space is the highest, is the height of the lower line letter. And also, this chart can be available in Landolt C, Tumbling E, as well as in Numbers also. Okay, so now how do you notate the visual acuity? So when you're beginning to write the visual acuity, we all routinely write it in Snellen's. But when you start writing papers or you're going to do research, most of the people follow the metric system, a fraction in feet or in decibels or in logMAR. So you should know how to convert Snellen's visual acuity into as a fraction in meters. So this is a 6/6 in meters, can be converted into 20/20 in feet, and decimal is 1. And log of this decimal, log 1 is the logMAR, which is 0. So a Snellen's score of 6/6 indicates a logMAR of 0 because log of 1 is 0. Similarly, Snellen's score of 6/12 or 20/40 in feet corresponds to a log of 0.3 because log of 0.5 is approximately 0.3. And some of them can be expressed as percentage visual acuity also. So that was about, in a nutshell, about the logMAR and the Snellen's chart. Now we come to the color vision. So color vision, we all know, is the ability to distinguish the various colors, and it's a function of cones. So we know there are 3 types of cones. We have the rod sensitive cones, erythrolates, or the long wavelength cones, the green sensitive ones, the chlorolates, or the medium wavelength ones, the blue sensitive pigments, or the cyanolates, the short wavelength sensitive cones. So our eyes are programmed to see colors between a wavelength of 400 to 700 nanometers, and below 400 is the ultraviolet, and above 720 is the infrared, which is beyond our visibility. So there are various theories of color vision. You need to know them for understanding some of the color vision abnormalities. The famous one is the Young-Helmholtz trichromatic theory. It says that a given color is an admixture of 3 primary colors in different proportion. And then you have the Herring's opponent theory, which says that some colors are mutually exclusive. And there is no, for example, there is no color like the reddish green. So in a nutshell, I'll just tell you the types of color blindness. So this picture on the left shows you the normal vision of a group of, color pencils, which is shown. Then you have protanopia as in protanomalies, in which there is, various degrees of level of absence of rod cones, red cones. Then you have deuteranopias, where there is a decrease, there is an abnormality of the green cones in various levels. Deuteranopia and deuteranomalies are grouped in this group. And then you have the tritanopia, when there is blue cones are deficient. So this is how the person with the particular color blindness will see the picture. So what is the basis for the testing the color vision, or why do you want to test color vision? So basically, they can be grouped as screening tests, grading tests, diagnostic tests, or vocational tests. So screening tests are for quick diagnosis using the plates, like the pseudo-isochromatic plates of Ishihara. Grading tests need to assess the severity of the defect, like the Farnsworth-Mansfield 100 hue test. Then you have the diagnostic test to precisely classify a defect using the anomaloscope. And you have certain vocational tests to simulate environment encountered on the job, like the lantern test. So I'll just tell you briefly. So the commonly used test is the plate test of the pseudo-isochromatic chart of Ishihara. The advantage is it's inexpensive, durable, and readily available, an efficient screening tool for congenital red-green defects. But the disadvantage is you cannot grade the severity of the color vision defect. So prototype is the Ishihara's test designed by Shinoba Ishihara. It's a series of cards in which a figure is printed in multiple colors against a multicolored background. It's called pseudo-isochromatic because there is a vanishing figure to the color defective. The color plates are circles in multiple patterns, and the figures are recognizable to most normal trichromats, whereas they are camouflaged or vanishing to those with the color vision defects. So let's see, it is available as 38 plate edition, usually. Sometimes it can have a 24 or a 14 plates. So this is the entire 38 plate chart of the Ishihara's. The plate one is the demo plate, or the number 12, which can be read or easily by all patients, in spite of the fact whether they are colorblind or not. And it's not considered for making a score. Then you have 2 to 9 plates, which are transformation plates. So individuals with color vision defect will see a different figure in these transformation plates. Whereas then you have the 10 to 17 plates, which are the vanishing optotypes. So here only the normal person can see the figure, whereas the person with the color vision may not see the figure. Then 18 to 21 are the hidden digital plates. So only individuals with color vision defect can recognize the figure here. So that those with normal color vision will not see the figure. And then you have plates 22 to 25, which are the diagnostic plates. These are intended to determine the type of the color vision defect. For example, whether it's a protanope or a deuteranope. So protons, so for example, if you look at this plate, the protanopes will only see the number on the right, that is the 6, whereas the deuterons will only see the number on the left, that is the number 2. So then you have certain tracing plates from 26 to 38. So instead of reading the number, the subject is asked to trace the line, which is visible across the plate. So how do you test for color vision? Patient is seated comfortably with adequate daylight and preferably done before the dilatation of pupil with full refractive correction in place. Each eye is tested separately and the plates are kept at 2/3 meter from the subject at right angles to the line of vision. And you give about 3 to 5 seconds per plate for analyzing the plate. So now you have various other tests like the arrangement test called the Farnsworth-Mansfield 100 hue test. So this is a very detailed exhaustive test. You have colored caps of fixed color and value. And there are 4 boxes. Each box consists of 1/4 of the color circle, and total about 85 color samples are there. And between the caps, there is a very small difference in the colors, and the patient is asked to arrange randomly placed caps in the natural order of color. And patient requires good color vision and chromatic discrimination to perform this test. And finally, it is recorded as in this chart. So we have a smaller version of this known as the Farnsworth-Mansfield D15 color vision test. It's a single trait with 15 independent color hues, and the primary purpose is to identify the color vision defects and not to grade it, basically the red, green, and blue, yellow color sensing deficiencies. So word about anomaloscope. So it is used to basically to grade the color vision defects. It's quite accurate basically for the red green color vision defects. So here you have a telescopic barrel through which the subject looks at a circular field, and he has to match the upper and lower field by mixing a combination of red and green light. So the disadvantage is that it's quite challenging, and you need a trained technician to interpret the color vision defect. So thus it's not very frequently used, though it's quite accurate. Now we come to a certain test which are used in certain vocations like lantern tests. So they're commonly used by the railway industries, maritime and air industries to screen their employees. So it measures the subject's competency to recognize colored light signals in the particular environment. And the subject is asked to name the colors presented to them, and individuals with defective color vision make a certain characteristic color vision mistakes in naming the colors. And based on this, the test is interpreted. So that was in a nutshell about the various color vision tests and the visual acuity charts commonly used. Thank you.